I am Varun Anbalagan from Chennai. I am studying class 10. I uploaded a story called Club Combat in Novella. And I am going to read it for you. This story is in first person narrative. It's about a guy named Tom Hiddleston and his friend who in the search for life enters into an action-packed and interesting turn. They find many surprises in their way. Will they find what they were searching for, or will they even know what they were searching for? Come on, let's read it. Club Combat by Varun Anbalagan. It's me. I heard the bell ring 7 times. Fine, please, ho, said a host as we got up to leave. Bro, shall I come over tonight? Asked John, an obese guy of 20 with a chubbiest face, my only friend at the palliative center. I rejected his offer. I don't usually entertain guests at my home. They make my condition worse. No, not in that way. I don't have cancer or tuberculosis. The thing is, I can't sleep at all. My mind never calms down. My body doesn't care. It's always very tired. I can never sleep. And people don't consider the disease of mine called insomnia terminal, like cancer. But only I know the problems I face. People like me know the problems I face. Because of this, I keep thinking almost every time. Every second, my brain never stops working. But now I feel like I'm the most depressed guy in the world. I almost hate to live. But I'm not depressed enough to commit suicide. The palliative center is not curious. It just helps us die peacefully without blaming anyone. And it actually helps me to die if he wasn't bad. The next day, I read an article about a guy who was arrested for a forgery case. Gregory F.D., a rich guy, had bought a car made of pure gold at an auction last year. He had made hollow gold bars with that and sold it double the car's rate. Wow, what a life. And he had also unhesitatingly paid a fine of $2,000. Wow, now that's worth living for, I thought. Tom Hiddleston, the name of my boarding pass rate. It was torn one off given to me. This way and right, so said a nice looking lady in a red airline skirt who called herself an air hostess. I waited for almost an hour to the screen to load up. I clicked movies. The options were so poor that I switched off the screen. Lack of interest in it to the dark, almost muscular guy with a good hairstyle who had seen fights before and who had been fights before. But I think it is a lack of interest to not see the blockbuster of the year. Yes, it was in the list. He looked like a guy in insurance, even worse for that matter, depressed, dying, and fed up with life. I also took the privilege of taking a look at your ticket, Hiddleston, said that guy. You are Gregory Heffley, aren't you? I asked, assuming the guy in the newspaper. Yes, I'm Greg, he replied. I'm thinking of running a soap company in Texas. I would like you to have you as a sales executive in Boston. And yes, my card. He handed over me a visiting card. Now I'm okay, Greg. Yes, I like interest for movies, but here's where you're wrong. I'm not yet fed up with life. I'm just too tired of dying. Yes, I did make that comment. And I ain't working as no sales executive, I said. 6 days after this flight, I found myself looking at an apartment building in flames. I had to shout to make myself audible among the tension and confusion. That's my flat, officer! Why would I blow it? It's the only thing that I move, I said to the police officer inquiring me. I don't care how you have to blow it up. It's clear that it's homemade dynamite as CCTV didn't record any man carrying a ready-made one, he replied. So why would I say no? Suspicion, boy, so we can't do anything to help you. I say you call a friend, family and save them for some days. But I don't have one, I said. That's another reason. You know, among the flat as a depressed guy who not hesitate to commit suicide, so I can't do anything about it. I couldn't think of anyone. And I absolutely could not stay with cancer, John. I felt a card poke my chest. I turned to see phone booth. I got no other option. Please try again later, said an annoying woman for the 10th time in the phone. Just as when I got the call and turned away to go, the phone rang again. I immediately picked it up to hear a man. Hi, it's Gregory here. Hey, it's me, Tom. Hey, recognize my offer, eh? Yeah, but not in that way. I just need a place to stay. Yeah, sure. What is my home in Texas? We'll be partners if you could just invent a few $1,000. That's a decent offer, Greg. Where can we meet? What about Chase and Rumor Street? At 10. Sounds fine. Thanks for the week. It was so quick. The next day, I spotted Greg sitting in the most highest place in the restaurant. Hey, he waved at me and continued. I have a contractor to go and talk now, so stay till night. I'll meet you at the Texas airport. Here's a ticket. He handed over an envelope. I don't know why I need to go such a far distance from home. But it was better than the streets. Thanks for what I said as I left the hotel desk. I took out a belief the waiter stared at me like I was a jerk. Just one more glass, said Greg. We were in a bar celebrating my safe arrival at Texas. I just made a snack. I tend to get drunk in my effort to go to sleep every night. Now I was addicted to it. But mark me, it's the worst thing to get addicted to. I said, no, I need to walk back home. Let's get mad. We went out to face the cool air blowing at my face. We both stumbled, trying to hold each other for support. I was a very little bit uncomfortable, about 2%, about the guy who wanted me for a sales executive suddenly behaving like a best friend. But he was not like others, as I found out his interests were similar to mine. Punch me, he said. What? I asked. Just punch me in the face, he said again. I was too drunk to protest, so I fulfilled his request. And his nose was bleeding the next minute. But my monkey of a brain, which was too drunk, did not stop with just one. I delivered 4 more punches. Now my turn, said Greg, and threw some punches off his wound. This became a full-fledged duel in a matter of a few minutes. A few guys coming out of the bar saw us like a rat made of bulldogs on the street. Actually, we were. They crowded around us and didn't leave until we fell down too tight to move. This happened almost every day until huge crowds started gathering around us. In mornings, we make soap at a study. I thought of more people at work, but they like to start from nothingness. At evenings, we get drunk and get hurt very badly. He soon became popular at the bar. One day, a guy from the crowd offered to fight Greg. Seeing him, many people started fighting with each other. Bleeding was common for the guys at the bar entrance around 10 in the night. Seeing the number of people increase, Greg invited them to a basement bar to fight every night. He had given up drinking with other guys I gave up drinking along with the other guys as my interest now became having broken jaws and flat faces. All these people were examples of contradictions to my hypothesis that I was the only guy hating my life. We started organizing proper fights inside a ring with the referee. These people have nothing to do. They are depressed. They don't have a purpose. Fighting gives them a role in life. They fight in life and for life. You ask, when were they not? When? The previous fights didn't earn a reward. Now they know your best fight against more importance. So what do you say we give them a chance of a new life? We could equip them for a company, said Grant, before going to a bed. Good idea, I remembered to myself. We will call ourselves the Club Combat, announced Greg. We fight at lives and for a life. I know many of you guys don't have a job. What do you say I give you one? I'm only a few members of some soap company. Doesn't seem like business, but let's start small. Let's make money in the morning and fight in the evening. I already have contractors and buyers. What about you? Every hand was up. Do me a favor now, he said to me in private. Don't ever mention me to the club members. Ever. It was an odd request, but I agreed. He had also sent me to lay as low as possible in Texas one day. I guess it was a scare. I had been club coming for a couple of years now. There were so many youngsters in the club now. Some older members had migrated and set up club combat at other cities. They had used them as supply centers for supplying soap. Greg had called us to a fight arena at 11, a time usually when we fight wet matches. He started. Members of our club in New Jersey had been arrested for creating violence among minors. We showed what we got and they were interested. It wasn't our mistake. We fight for our life together now. How did you and you and you become together? He continued pointing at some of our new members. By fighting, a method by which normal people get separated. We are different. We didn't know anything when we didn't have a life. Now we try to live and they beat us up. That's not right. He finished. A young guy asked, so what do you say? He was a guy who had almost knocked the best fighters off. David Deacon. He was a guy in his early 20s with a lean and muscular body and a stomacher. Greg replied, the world's changing. It's time we change it. I say, we do some mixing. Wow. For the next half year, the club had isolated itself. Greg had ordered the materials needed for soap drinking for a year in advance. The next day, we assembled in front of Greg. He started. This is what we change. We are making soap with this anymore. We make dynamite. I said our other clubs to say hello as well. We sell these to people who can do our job. The youngsters were all excited, but they didn't like this. I like the idea to bring together a group of remarkable people, but becoming a criminal gang, it wasn't good. But it didn't protest either. Supposedly, a part of me liked this. Since I showed no participation, the members ignored me. When I woke up that day, Greg and the others were gone. They left without me. I spent the whole morning alone until they came back at night. "He's calling," said David, holding out a phone. "Who's this?" asked the man on the other side. "You called us, Mr. Governor," said David. "Just say your demand." "What's the catch?" "Trust me, spare my wife and children. I'll give you whatever you want." "Legal authorization is what we want in 3 days," said David. Greg moved his lips with no sound. His words were repeated by George, and a ransom of $40,000, he said before ending the call. "What happened?" I asked. Greg replied, "We had kidnapped the governor's family and set a dynamite around his house. Set him to stay quiet if demands are, you know, how outlined. Greg had gone with 4 members one day to a hotel and killed the governor after a month of release of the authorization. He didn't spare his family too. Greg had formed a militia with beer and soap."
Wow.
"This became the main job for members later. They sold dynamites illegally, soap legally, did kidnapping contracts, and Greg even kidnapped famous people for bonuses." Greg had kidnapped some members of the AIC, a growing crime organization wanting to become the shadow government of the USA. He struck a deal that they could not refuse. "We do the fieldwork for them and they fund us and clear us of our cases." He also occasionally kidnapped a rich guy's family. Just to show his power. "Now that we had legal authorization, we can participate in events and competitions. Club Combat had recently won the championship cup in Suburban Boxing League through David Bleeker. This had made Greg famous too. Bleeker was the second in command now. All the members are packing one night." "You're leaving me again," I said to Greg. He replied, "Because you're unfit." "And why is that?" "At first I thought you weren't ready," he replied. "Now that I know you are unfit, I tried to give you a life led by your principles, but you would just make something out of it. When did you..." I was interrupted. "Why do you think I blew your house?" "You what?" "I hope you would learn something. I hope you would learn to live if I thought to survive. I was wrong." I stormed out of the place without hearing further conversation. I grabbed my purse on the way. On the way, I met Bleeker. "How are you doing, David?" I asked. I wasn't upset with him. "I'm better than you, Gregory," he replied and continued. "Did he just call me Greg? Greg's name?" I was in my room in Hotel Blanc as I got a video call. It showed a newspaper ad of spaghetti. The kiddish voice on the other end replied, "Let's eat spaghetti with the hair of a yeti." Wonderful. A prank call. My life sucks. I didn't end the call, but I was silent. Let alone I had handled it. So when they turned the phone, I got a glimpse of a stout Asian guy as he got a glimpse of mine. "Hey, that's Gregory, the owner of the club for which David fought." I ended the call. "Who was the friend calling me Greg?" I was confused. "I called John. I didn't have any other guy to call." "Yeah, what's up, man? It's about Tom," he replied. He replied, "Who? Hey, you've been Tom for a long time now, aren't you? When are you becoming Greg again?" I dropped the phone not because of what John said, but because Greg was sitting right in front of me. "I asked you one favor," he said. "Not to mention me." "Then why did..." I stopped him in sentence. "What's happening here?" I shouted at his face. "Try to think. I can't think of anything. Maybe what?" Evelyn said, "Come on, tell it loud." "I'm actually you and you're actually me, something like that," I said. "Quite near," he started. "You are you and I am also you. I am like a second personality of yours. I was developed as a result of you trying to bring yourself back to get a role in the society. Now you are the leader of the most feared club in Texas and the most loved club in the South." "But the guy who went in the plane was real. But then, how can anyone call a public phone booth?" The other pieces came together. Everyone was attracted to the fighting at the bar, not because two people were fighting madly, it's because I was fighting myself badly. And I was viewing myself in third person at Greg. And the guy at 3S2 looked at me like a psychopath. "But this can't be true," I said to myself. As if to prove his point, Greg vanished from this place, not leaving any trace of his arrival. He was there a few seconds ago. I opened the door to find no one in the hallway. I dialed David's number. Hey, give me the missile shots quickly now, I said to him. He replied, yeah, New York, Empire State Building, hydrogen bomb, set up with dynamites, van, contracts over. So that means it's a rendezvous at, I said. He replied, A to factory unit, car park, he replied. I got the call. Chris Penn was swimming in my mind. I'm not that dull to not know the gods used by a club. I immediately rushed to the rendezvous point in my car. On the way, I was thinking about how the plan to set up a hydrogen bomb using dynamite for the AIC is taking a deal with the president in Japan to give them a trade monopoly or support their operations in the USA. End it, David, I said, booming over like Greg does. Abort mission. Now, today, don't speak. I know it. Discussion at 10. He said, but sir, you said never to stop this, ever. But it's me who, I said when David interrupted me, saying, you said to stop this, even if it's you saying to, sir. This is more of a lecture. Clever Greg, clever me, I thought. Now you can't convince anyone, but I mustn't show weakness. I whispered to David, what did I say you to do if I didn't stop, Bleaker? I called him by his champion name of Bleaker for the first time. I mean, Greg had for him. Sir, you stopped looking me in the eye. He had fallen for it. I looked at the Empire State Building as it was saying something. I was reading the lines I would need now. For a strong man, Bleaker, David Bleaker. You know what the Empire wants, what the state wants, but not what the building wants. That's why you're strong. I need you to be powerful. It's true that Adonis Bleaker was the most powerful guy in America. You're not the strongest one. I said this to David in private as David was escorting me to an ambulance van. He said that I had ordered myself to be locked up in locker 407. For the members of club combat, lockers mean abandoned buildings of previous members of the club. I thank God for Greg not ordering me a death sentence. I was in a building far away from the Empire State Building. I had come here by flight. My life, as I realized now, has no meaning, and it has never had. It is the meaning, I realized. It defines me. Okay, enough of philosophy. I need to explain my brilliant plan. I had called him David Bleaker, a name he's proud of, but Greg has never called him by that name. By empire, I meant the AIC, and by state, I meant the United States. By building, I meant what we have built so far, our club combat, our legacy. We made our legacy on American soil, but that's one of the things that still defines us. I didn't want it to get undermined. It meant, and I made a petition to, Empire State Building. So it was a pun. I motivated David by mentioning his father, Adonis Bleaker, who had won many championships by fighting for America. Adonis joined our club because of his passion for boxing, even when his family did not encourage him. I appealed to his ambition, his father's legacy, and our club's foundation. His mind is now perfectly balanced, as all things should be. He will definitely take the decision I want him to make. For my part, I took out my phone and started dialing. Japan, a voice said. It was Greg standing in front of me. Even I can keep secrets, Greg, I said. Hello, Nguyen here, said a small boy in the phone. Hey, Hudson, how are you doing? Can I get to the vice president? I asked. Hudson, the governor's boy, exclaimed Greg. I had kidnapped him. He would not come with me. Yeah. On the way from school, I saved him when I got a species of Greg going to a hotel with just three members. His mother, unfortunately, did not make it. Hudson was adopted by the BP, who was best friend of the governor. I almost forgot about this. And this thought was so deep in my mind, Greg had no way to know about it. Did it work? Anything on favor? The BP asked this bold voice. Yeah, I say you offer protection. Are you confident? Affirmative. If I had convinced David to abort the mission, I would have said him to go for a concession that is offering AIC's trade monopoly. But after what's about to happen, trade will be disrupted. So AIC will not be happy, and Club Comet will not be happy. And that is one of the things that made me this. So protection was a better option, which is to support the AIC operation in the USA and at the same time not undermining USA's position in the world. The dome of the building had a telescope, which was showing the Empire State Building, Greg's work. Now all I have to do was wait and watch. Now the narrative is changing to David Bleaker, and it's about what's going on in his mind. I felt that this was just a test at first, but why sacrifice his reputation? I was convinced about this when I heard what Greg he had to say me near the van. When he said I was strong, he said I had qualities. When he said I wasn't powerful, he meant that I was not independent. He knew that I know what I knew what empire set in building meant. I had taken my decision on my own. Not like the previous time. I understood what he had wanted to convey. It was a motto. Don't sacrifice immorality, but don't hesitate to drop your acquired values if you want to live. I was standing at a safe distance from the building. A dark, muscular man was staring at me from the glass. He was saying what he said, confident as my decision was my own this time and it will be right. I received a message from Gregory which said he will survive. The message was supposed to be Greg survives. Sir Gregory revealed his birth name to me. I pressed the switch upon receiving the message, which had the bombs creating an explosion big enough to engulf the building in flames. I didn't halt the operation. I just took the hydrogen bomb off the equation. I showed the power of the AIC, the Emperor, by blowing the building, and the legacy of the USA, the state, as the building didn't get destroyed completely. And he also gave new leadership to Club Combat, the building, my leadership to Club Combat. Wow. Now, the narrative shifts back to our hero Tom 5 years later. 5 years later. Who to say it's true, Tom? Eliminate Raynard, said John into my earbud-sized earphones. I'm now waiting. I will start from the beginning. The bell rang 7 times, 5 feet. That's kidding. I'm not starting from that beginning. I just finished explaining my plan to Greg. I sent a message to David. Then a fat guy came running up the stairs. I didn't go with them, Tom. I knew he had become something more, John said. I knew. Funny guy, said Greg, looking at me. I knew this when you called me as Tom and not as Greg. John continued. After that, I stopped listening to him. Both Greg and me were wrong. I was fit to live, but not the life that Greg led. I didn't hate my country. Now I had indeed become something more. So when America needed us, I could fight their battles, but they never could. We too, Greg and me, became assassins while John was a guy in the chair. Our clients were people in the government, especially the VP, and our targets were the people in the AIC. We used the Club Combat to bring up the guy, and John got us the intel, and the government gave us access. I am one of the underworld's most feared assassins, or should I say, BR. Thanks for listening to my story, and I encourage you to read the story. It will be more interesting rather than listening to me.